Joining us now live in studio is Assembly Member Chad Mays. He represents the 42nd District. Assemblyman, thank you for joining us tonight. Let's talk a little bit about some of the tension that exists right now, or seems to exist more so than in recent memory, between the federal government, the state government, the county government, and then even down to the cities. You're kind of stuck in the middle of all that. You're in Sacramento, but you're also in your district, and also a lot of it depends on what's happening at the federal level. So can you tell me that, is it possible that we could get all of our levels of government to get to work together a little bit better?
Well, yes, I think you're absolutely right. There is some tension, and I'm one of those people that believe that we just got to be adults. We need to grow up, and we need to do the work of the people. We shouldn't be childish. We shouldn't act childish. We should be like adults and understand the threat before us and work together at all levels of government to be able to solve this problem together.
How much of the problem is sort of what reflected in your own political life? You're a Republican. You were chastised for working across the aisle with the Democrats on anything, whether you agreed with them or not. And so you've become an independent. Are we just seeing that sort of exacerbated during these turbulent times?
Well, I think there's a lot of people that are looking at the two parties today and going, hey, enough is enough with this partisan bickering. There are big issues before this country. There are big issues before this state. Just go do the people's work. And so it's great for me at this point because I don't have to play all the political games. I don't have to be on Team X or Team Y. I don't have to be a Republican or a Democrat. I can just do the work before me to be able to represent the people of this district and the people of California.
There's only been a small handful of successful independents across the country. Are you going to be able to survive as an independent going forward?
Oh, there's no question about it in my mind. I've represented this district now for 6 years, with the way that things are going today, there's no doubt that I'll be representing it for a couple more years.
Right. Let's talk a little bit about some of the confusing patchwork of guidelines and rules and regulations that are coming down, again, from the federal government, from the state, from the county, from the cities, and trying for people who just want to go out, but they want to be safe. And, of course, they want to follow the rules for the most part. Is there a way that this information could be streamlined as well?
Yeah, it really has been frustrating. I know we've been taking not dozens of calls, but really hundreds of calls in our office every single day, trying to sort through everything. You know, the state gives guidelines, and then of course there's the county guidelines as well. You know, when can I open up my business? Oh, how come my business can't open up, but yet there's another business that's opened up? And I think that's one of the things we haven't done very well. I think both the state and here locally, we haven't done a very good job in coordinating that information and getting. Although we have websites and there's news stations like this, but it has been very challenging getting information out and making it clear. So I think we can do a better job there.
Yeah, early on, Governor Newsom took some pretty heavy-handed steps statewide. A lot of people are crediting him for that, for possibly saving hundreds, if not thousands, of lives. But the Republicans in Sacramento didn't like some of the steps he was taking. They said he overstepped his authority. They took him to court, and a judge is now supporting the Republicans in this. Tell me where you are in this particular dogfight.
Well, I think early on, the governor received an incredible amount of praise, not just from the legislature, but also from the people of California, and moving very quickly. And I do believe that those early actions saved an awful lot of lives. But, you know, it's not as though he hasn't made any mistakes as well. I'm somebody that believes that the legislature should jealously hold on to the fact that it's got a constitutional role in this democracy in the state of California, and that the legislature should be acting. I do think that there's been too many executive orders, and so the action that you're referring to today was a case up in Northern California that a couple legislators sued, and there's been an injunction now to be able to stop one particular executive order.
What was that one particular executive order?
In regards to making the entire state a vote by mail.
It's the vote by mail.
Yeah.
Okay, so
it's just temporary. It's a temporary.
Right.
There'll be another judge and all of that. Yeah.
Well, and it's funny because we spoke with somebody from Common Core yesterday about that simple fact that maybe not across the board for every election going forward, but certainly in November, with cases continuing to rise and likely another wave in the fall, which would be a typical flu or virus season, Would it not make sense, at least this November, where 100% of registered voters can have the ability to vote by mail if they choose to do so?
I certainly agree. In fact, we actually have that ability today. I've voted by mail virtually my entire adult life. I'm a big fan of voting by mail. In fact, I don't have a problem at all of moving to that system where everybody votes by mail. But I do think that the legislature needs to be the one to be able to make that decision, and it shouldn't be done by executive order. It should go through the normal process, regular order, and there should be a bill, and then we should go through and debate that bill, and instead of just being an executive order. But I do think we are moving towards a mail ballot, and I'm supportive of that.
All right. We got lots more with Assemblyman Chad Mays right after the break. Stick around.
This is an NBC Palm Springs special report. Coronavirus facts, not fear. Presented by East Valley COVID-19 testing site, serving residents of Eastern Coachella Valley.
Continue our conversation now with Assembly Member and recently engaged Chad Mays. Again, Chad, thanks for joining us tonight. Let's talk about government now, because things are certainly not settled, but it feels like we're going to reopen, and frankly, we're throwing a little caution to the wind. The numbers keep going up, the deaths keep going up, but like most people, we have to reopen the economy. We can't just stay in our homes forever without it severely damaging everything that we know. So the budgets across state, county, and certainly cities, the deficits are exploding. Is there any game plan coming out of Sacramento for how to plug some of these holes?
Well, you know, it's something we're obviously very concerned about. The governor in his May revise came out and said there's going to be a $54 billion drop in the budget compared to where he was at in January. You know, the legislative analyst office says it's probably around $31 billion. But regardless if it's $54 billion or $31 billion, those are significant numbers, which is going to have an impact on so many state programs, state funding. It is of deep concern for us. So we're going to have to tighten our belts. We also understand that the counties and cities are also greatly impacted by this. And so I know that there have been cities here in the Coachella Valley that are having to tighten their belts as well. And so it's something of concern. We'll get beyond this. But when you think about the economy, when you think about this pandemic, we can't forget that it's the economy that drives our government. It's not the government that drives the economy. And it's important to make sure to be able to have some balance.
Yeah, let's talk about things that could be cut. Because, let's face it, the bulk of the money goes to either public safety and teachers. Two things no one likes to cut. So beyond that, I mean, where can the cuts happen? And at some point, do we have to raise registration on our vehicles again? Do we have to increase taxes again? How do we plug a $30 or $50 billion hole?
Well, right now, today, in fact, probably late into this evening, the budget negotiators are working on this. The legislative leaders, along with the governor's office, are working on that. The governor had his proposal. The legislative leaders have their proposal, and it looks like as much as next week, we're going to be voting on a budget. So it's gonna be some belt tightening, and nobody's gonna like the budget. But it's one of those things that we're gonna have to rise to the occasion, and we're going to have to do some belt tightening, and we'll do just that.
Right. And while we're trying to tighten our belts, one of the things that's going to come up is this additional help that we're giving to the unemployed or the furloughed right now, people that are out of work through no fault of their own, and they're just kind of waiting for their industry or their business to get back on track so they can go back to work. But in the meantime, the money's running out from the federal level to give a little extra in the unemployment check. That's going to hit the same time that you're talking about tightening our belts. How do we handle both of those?
Yeah, there's no question about it. I can tell you that the calls that we're getting in our office, even today, dealing with unemployment, EDD, the lack of being able to pick up the phone and be able to speak to somebody. The numbers are overwhelming. And if you listen to the folks that are calling, they're at the end of their rope. And they're not sure what to do. We've had calls from folks saying, you know, I've never thought in my life I'd ever have to go to the food bank. And here I am. I'm having to go to the food bank to be able to feed my family because they're waiting on that unemployment check to be able to get them through this. These are tough times for sure. And we're doing what we can at the state government. There's been a bipartisan effort to work with the state agency, the EDD, to say, what's going on? How come you can't move faster? So it seems like they're They're starting to get ahead. I shouldn't say ahead. They're catching up to where they've been behind, but they still have an awful lot of work to do.
As you head back to Sacramento and as we wrap this up tonight, is there any silver lining? Is there anything that you're seeing statewide that maybe could give us a little ray of hope that there will be something positive in the next 3, 6, 9 months?
You know, the one thing I would say that does give me a ray of hope is I've really been amazed at how the people of California have really risen to the occasion. I was just in Home Depot earlier today and just seeing that everybody's still keeping their social distancing, still keeping their mask on. People understand that there's a responsibility that they have to making sure that they're taking care of themselves and taking care of the health of their neighbors and loved ones. And to me, that gives me an incredible ray of hope. The American people, Californians, are an innovative, a persistent group of people. And we're going to get through this, and at the end of it, we're going to be stronger for it, for sure.
All right. Assemblyman Chad Mays, thank you, as always, sir, for spending a little time with us and helping us understand what is a pretty rough time in the history of California. And we're glad you're there. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Gino. Thanks for having me.
We'll be back after the break.